I told you, I'm the real champion. I told you, I'm the champion of the world. All of you bow. All of our critics bow. All of you suckers bow. All of you suckers bow.
Muhammed Ali, the King of the Ring. I met him, knew him, and fought him. And for anyone involved in boxing, Ali is a legend and an inspiration. And as he always reminded us, he was the greatest. Remember the time he dazzled Sonny Liston?
Crisp lightning punches by Muhammed Ali.
And that stinging left jab, I can feel it now.
It's round five.
He had a heart of a lion.
Ali not letting up for a moment.
And a lot of people forgot he could be mean as well as clever.
Ali on target with every punch.
But Ali had another quite unique weapon, his mouth. No one could match the Louisville lip in a war of words, either inside or outside the ring.
In the coop is nothing to me. If this bum go over five rounds, I won't return to the United States for 30 days.
Ali was the complete fighter. He had it all. But it wasn't just one talent that made him great. If you take a close look at his career, you'll see that in the ring, he lived by five rules, laws if you like. They allowed him to conquer the world. You're about to discover what made Ali the complete fighting machine. So sit back, relax, and watch the master at work.
Muhammad Ali is acknowledged as the fastest heavyweight in the history of the division. Some say he was quite simply the quickest boxer the world has ever seen. Remember the Ali shuffle? His hands were pretty quick as well.
No one could move like Ali did. His footwork was more like watching a sporting ballet, and he was mesmeric. I mean, his speed was such that his opponents were totally mesmerised by him. They were mesmerised by him before they got in the ring, but once they got in there, they couldn't get anywhere near him.
He's moving as if he wasn't a heavyweight. He's moving as if he was in a lighter division. And when you start talking about somebody 6'3", 15, 16 stone, that's a compliment, I think. That's the thing about Ali. He danced as if he came from two or three divisions lighter. Boxing.
When he took on Sonny Liston in their first world title fight, Liston just couldn't get near him.
The challenger will move to both sides, but primarily clockwise, to avoid the champion's best punch, that left hook.
Ali was a huge 7-1 underdog as the challenger. Nobody thought he'd survive Liston's powerful punches.
Liston was a powerful man, and he looked like the ogre taking on the playboy. When it came to the fight, Liston, of course, became increasingly frustrated. Liston came forward, as he had against so many beaten, solid, large, good guard, and there was this person dancing around.
Liston puts on the pressure now, trying to land that one big punch.
Liston's continual chasing of Ali made him extremely tired. He just couldn't seem to land a punch.
Well, he knew it was going to be difficult anyway, Liston, and I don't think he'd come up against anything like that before. Not only could he move on his feet, it wasn't just running away. He was backed up with the punches. He could make a move, make an opening, and then really do the business with the punches.
The 8-1 underdog takes the offensive. instructed in his corner to take the lead. Clay now sets the pace. That left hook is Clay's best punch up to this point. After Clay backs Liston to the ropes, he verbally challenges the champion, sets him up for the left-right combination that opens a cut under Liston's eye.
By the time Liston got to the end of the sixth round, it had all become too much. He didn't reappear for the seventh, complaining of a mysterious shoulder injury.
Liston's shoulder went out. He could not continue. Winner by a TKO in the seventh round, Cassius Clay.
I am the king of the world.
Hold it. You're not that pretty.
I'm a bad man.
Wait.
I shook up the world.
I'm not saying he didn't have an injured shoulder, but certainly he was frustrated. He hadn't been badly hurt, but he'd been hit, and he'd been outthought, and he'd been conned, and he was being made to look a fool.
That flamboyant shuffle epitomized Ali's foot speed.
The second I do this shuffle, whatever you have planned, you're going to either forget it or you're going to look at my feet.
The Ali shuffle was his trademark. You know, some show-off boxers like Benitez, they've got these certain things, but that was him. And it's more or less showing off, but it's also demoralizing the opponent. Because when you're giving your best and you think, OK, I've got a chance here, and someone does that in front of you, it's almost like taking the rise out of you. There's certain gifts that people have got, and Ali had the magic, and no trainer in the world could give him that. It's something you're born with, you know, it's agility of feet and movement and thinking is brilliant. I think of all the heavyweights I've seen over the last 50 years, he was the fastest thing on 2 feet.
Not a heavyweight in the world fast enough to stop me.
While Ali's ability to dance inevitably diminished over the years, his hand speed was something he never lost. Here he is against Zora Foley in 1967 at Madison Square Garden. Seven years later, Ali was still able to put together blistering combinations against George Foreman in Zaire.
And I've had guys spar with him, and they've come back to the corner and said, I never saw the punches coming. I just see a feint, and it was there, you know.
He was never the hardest punch in heavyweight. He punched a bit harder as he got older and got slightly slower. But his early days, what he did, he used to hit opponents with a cluster of punches, say 10, 12 punches, and he would just fluster them and confuse them, and half the times the referee had to jump in to stop the other fighter being hit or being damaged.
Punches by Clay.
It didn't matter that he wasn't a one-punch knockout artist. The cumulative effect was just the same. That was the way he eventually demolished Zora Foley in the seventh round. Even after the enforced 3.5-year layoff, Ali's hand speed was still there. It was responsible for destroying Jerry Quarry.
Ali says, come on, and he caught him. Caught him two lovely ones to the chin. I reckon he's going to finish it now in this round. Yes, Quarry can't take any more. I'm surprised at Mike Kaplan, referee, not stopping it. Driven to retaliate. It's the bandage come loose in Ali's left glove. Catches him again. Where is he getting this energy from? A glazed, dazed Quarry.
half a minute to go. And he's fighting back from nowhere. Seconds to go, and Quarry, where is he getting it from? He's punched his heart out there, and he really cut Clay. Oh, Ali, and he fights back again as Ali now is infuriated. At least he did wipe some of the smile off Ali's face there. Ah, Ali out to finish it. Yes, it was a last stand, I think. It was Quarry's last gallant effort. Referee must stop. Yes, it's all over. All over, and rightly so, and not before it's time.
Well, while he's moving around with that blinding speed, nobody can hit him.
2.5 years after taking the world title from Sonny Liston, he produced what trainer Angelo Dundee described as Ali's greatest ever boxing exhibition. Cleveland Williams could neither land his own punches nor avoid Ali's.
A 1-2, and Williams goes down. Cleveland Williams. Floored for the first time in this fight. So referee Harry Kessler continues the count. Challenger Cleveland Williams floored for the first time in this fight. Now Clay moves in there. Throwing combinations. Landing all types of punches, and Williams goes down again.
Over three rounds, Ali landed 100 punches. Williams managed just three, and he was on the canvas four times.
Every fighter, in my opinion, has one peak performance. And I think Ali's was against Cleveland Williams. The speed is blinding, and he never missed a shot, and he delivered those blows so rapidly. Poor old Cleveland Williams, who wasn't a bad heavyweight, wasn't a great one, was treated as if he was a novice.
Ali's 1965 rematch with Sonny Liston is remembered for the sudden and controversial ending. A phantom punch, or was it Ali's lightning speed?
Now we're about to see one of the most controversial endings in the history of the heavyweight division. I want you to watch very carefully in a moment when we go into slow motion, Ali's right hand, and it gives you an idea just how fast he could punch. Now it's coming up now. Just watch the right hand very, very carefully. Brings it back, looking for an opening. Waiting, waiting. Now, bang. Now, no one to this day is sure where that punch landed. Did it hit him on the chin, or did it hit him on the side of the head? I think the punch probably landed on the side of the head, because that is far more dangerous for a fighter to be caught there than on the chin, because it completely disorientates you. It was so quick. People started calling the fight a fix, which is rubbish. You can't fix the world heavyweight champion.
Henry Cooper's view is somewhat different.
I just believe Liston swallowed it. Liston found out in that first fight that Ali had the style that he couldn't handle. I don't think Liston ever got over that. And in the second fight, he just went in there, I think, just for the payday.
But did Ali have the fastest hands of any heavyweight?
Tyson was incredibly fast, but also when he was a young man. He would hit you with three or four shots in what seemed like a split second. Very interesting to compare to see who was the faster of the two.
Well, I would say Tyson is second. You know, he's very fast, right? He's chunky, short, and he hasn't got the reach like Ali and things like that. But he has got terrific hand speed, but not the repetition of punches that Ali's got.
The jabbing speed of the great Sugar Ray Robinson has been compared to Ali's. Sugar Ray's averaged out at 0.36 seconds. Ali's was quicker, 0.27. That's less than a third of a second to throw one punch.
Thank you.
face, Ken. Yeah.
Good close-up.
You can see the effects of all of those punches.
The jab, every boxer's basic tool. Ali not only had one of the fastest, but also one of the most accurate. Here's Canadian George Chevallo on the receiving end in 1966.
In the light trunks. George Chevallo, the Canadian, in the darker trunks. Just keeps going ahead. He never stops.
This is what it did to Floyd Patterson.
So you can see now that this left eye of Patterson's really is closing in the seventh round.
And Henry Cooper suffered even worse damage.
You could never stand off of Ali and try to outbox him because he could jab your head, he could jab your head off and make you look silly.
Cooper's left eye is pouring blood.
In his first fight with Ali, Cooper was stopped, suffering from a terrible cut.
It's round five.
It was a similar result in their return fight 3 years later.
The two cut eyes I got with Ali were the worst cuts I ever had in boxing. Ali was a flicker, he was a long puncher, he dragged your flesh.
It was quick and it was accurate, and it was like a homing pigeon, he never missed. The great thing about Ali, he could throw it accurately when he appeared to be off balance, going backwards at some considerable speed.
There's a lot of talk about boxing in this altitude and whether Foster is better prepared for it as he lives at altitude.
Bob Foster, the former world light heavyweight champion, had a venomous jab of his own. Outweighed by more than 40 pounds, he got involved in a jabbing battle with Ali when they met in 1972.
He knows it all. He knows he can bide his time. On the other hand, can you imagine what would happen if Foster teed off and landed a punch on Ali's chin? I think you could hear him roar around the world if that happened. That's what they call in fight circles, taking a bit of a liberty. Foster's getting through with those left hands. I wonder if he's going to pay for it. And they're yelling from Ali's corner now, double them up, he needs to use those punches in flurries. That really is a red swelling there around Ali. That's really the topic of conversation here, I think. Those left hands, they really are thrusting Foster up the whole time.
The jabbing battle was even Steven by the end of the sixth. But as we'll see later, Ali had been toying with his opponent. Here in his second fight with George Chevallo in 72, the accuracy of Ali's jab is again a feature.
But sometimes from a hard blow thrown by Chevallo, you can see glances of concern across Ali's face. They're reflexes. They do hurt, but they wish. That's just a slip. Chevallo is landing more to the body than previous opponents have, and he can't hurt. As I report to you, Chevallo still breathing very well, not appearing to be out of gas, even though he has chased Muhammad Ali considerable distance. They're fighting inside an 18-foot ring. Earlier this afternoon, they hoisted a 16-foot ring.
But Ali ensured all his punches were accurate, not just the jab.
Both men ripping, tearing, bombing punches at each other.
Ali now with a goal over, gets away from him and can by Chevallo.
It was yet another Ali victory.
The art there, a counterpunch, you make the guy come, just slip in and taking half a pace backwards to make movement and hitting him with a left hook or a right. They're dying arts. Ali had that all. He had it all. So that's what made him so special.
If you slow films up, you can see them land always on the target area, round the head, round the side of the jaw.
Wants to keep Joe off of him. Crisp lightning punches by Muhammad Ali.
They seem almost as if he was threading a needle. They're so accurate sometimes.
This is a classic example of the change in Ali's style. When he fought Big Ron Lyle here for the world title in 1975, Ali, as you can see, is much thicker set man. He's a much heavier man, but he keeps him back. Is back to the ropes, raining punches on him, and most of them are extremely accurate, getting home on the target. He's constantly punching to the head, he's not bothering about the body, and lefts and rights, straight rights, left hooks, crosses, they all smash against Lyle's head.
We see that final avalanche of punches that turned this fight completely around. Ali on target with every punch. Lyle jolted backward. Ali not letting up for a moment. Ali actually signals to the referee to stop the fight. This is champion Muhammad Ali at his brilliant best. Muhammad Ali raining punches on Ron Lyle. And finally, the referee steps in and stops the fight. Muhammad Ali scores an 11th round knockout over Ron Lyle in Las Vegas and successfully defends his heavyweight championship.
You've got to miss with some because there's two people in there. But the law of average, if he threw 20 punches, you can say 17 would catch you.
Joe's gonna come out smoking, and I ain't gonna be joking. I'll be pecking and a poking, pouring water on his smoking. Then this might shock and amaze you, but I will destroy Joe Frazier. Some people say you better watch Joe Frazier, he's awful strong. I said tell him to try Band Roll On. That's deodorant.
No one could match the Louisville lip in a war of words, either in the ring or outside.
His number one job was to make sure people bought tickets to go and see him and make sure that the TV companies paid fortunes to put him on their screens. So that was his prime reason for a lot of his antics. But of course it did have a psychological bent as well, because he used to psych opponents out, no question about that.
Former heavyweight champion Floyd Patterson gets an unusual visitor at his private training camp.
So I want you to train hard. I come here in person. I come here. Back up. Back up. Come here to help you. I know you don't need the money to get in your name. But I'm going to make you another million. Okay, and you will have a chance to get the crown. And I just want to size you up. What makes you think you can whip me? What makes you think? Come on. Come on.
Be good. Tony was a small guy too. Let him train.
I don't want to mess with your trainer. I just want you to know that from now on, you are the rabbit.
He made his name with poetic predictions of which round his opponent would fall.
Here's the eighth round, exactly as it will happen.
Clay comes out to meet Liston, and Liston starts to retreat. If Liston goes back an inch farther, he'll end up in the ringside seat. Clay swings with his left. Clay swings with his right. Look at young Cassius carry the fight. Liston keeps backing, but there's not enough room. It's a matter of time, and Clay loads the boom. Now Liston disappears from view. The crowd is getting frantic, but our radar stations have picked him up. He is somewhere over the Atlantic. Liston is still rising, and the ref wears a frown, for he can't start counting till Sonny comes down. Who would have thought when they came to the fight that they'd witnessed the launching of a human satellite? Yes, the crowd did not dream when they put down that money that they would see a total eclipse of the Sonny.
I think it's the psychology of what round and trying to put that into the opponents is to say that you're in control, you've got the power, you're going to do it, you shouldn't really be in there, you know, because you're going to get hammered anyway. The opponent's supposed to think all this. I think that's what Ali was doing. And it's up to the individual if you allow that to happen, mentally.
Cassius, you got to fight this boy Cooper. You've been playing around for a long time, sporting it, as you
yes,
say.
Yes, I'm not training too hard for this bum. Henry Cooper's nothing to me. If this bum go over 5 rounds, I won't return to the United States for 30 days.
A lot of the British press said, oh, does it worry you what he's saying about you? I said, yeah, don't stop him. I said, he's earning me money. I said, he's dragging bums on seats that come in here. I said, selling tickets. I said, I'm on a percentage of the gate as well. I said, no, let him carry on. It didn't bother me. And that's how all fighters should have looked at it. But a lot of them didn't. A lot of them would be affected by it.
But Ali's ability to play mind games with his opponents wasn't limited to the run-up to the fight.
Many of the experts say, look at this, he's holding, he's exposing himself to Shivalo's punch.
And Clay was telling him to hit harder. At first throw I could hear it, Clay was saying, hit harder, hit harder.
He must have hit him 12 times with that right.
I remember when he boxed Shivalo, and I was talking to Angelo Dundee sometime afterwards. He said that for three days after he was passing blood in his urine, you know, and his ribs were terribly sore. So all those whacks here, it can't do you no good, but it does demoralise your opponent.
When he met Shivalo again 6 years later, Ali continued playing games with the Canadian.
This is another replay of the Ali and Shivalo match of
1967. Countless occasions when Ali, when he did get hit, and when he probably was hurt, he would feign that he was in distress by, you know, going weak at the knees and wobbling his behind as if he was about to go down, and shake his head again, saying, you know, I'm only pretending, you didn't really hurt me, when in fact he was probably hurt by a punch.
Over top with the right. Muhammad Ali. This is the thing that Muhammad Ali gets in the corner shook up with. 1 minute and 41 seconds left in this round. Ali may fight the last minute of the round.
And a trickle of blood right down the face, and there's a real mean look on Ali. Oh, and a right-hand shot. He's just pretending. He is just pretending. What a character, this man. He took Foster's best right-hand punch, and he's pretending that he's hurt. What a showman. Look at that. The whole world go crazy. They'll think that this fella's going down. But take my word for it, I'm 3 feet away, and he's taking no notice. This must be surely one of the most unique fighters in heavyweight history.
He's hitting with his best shot, and he's probably, he may think, well, all I've done with this fellow is upset him. I've awakened the sleeping tiger.
They're giving him every chance. No, he's out. His legs have gone like a kid in a playpen there.
Psychological warfare became an even more important part of Ali's armory when he took on George Foreman in 1974. By then, his footwork and speed were on the decline.
Look at the stare on George Foreman. Muhammad Ali beginning to talk to George Foreman. They're really putting the stare on each other. George Foreman has that serious look. Ali definitely talking to him. So the stage is set. We're just about ready to begin. Round one, the heavyweight championship of the world at stake.
The mental assault had already begun before the so-called Rumble in the Jungle.
This will be George Foreman's first title fight. George Foreman will be meeting the world heavyweight champion. And then he will get a new feeling and a new fear that he's never had before, especially when he sees the crowd. George Foreman is a dirty fighter. He is dirty. And I don't mean morally. His style is dirty. When he fought Joe Frazier, I got the feeling Frazier's moving this way. He saw it and deliberately hit him on the back of the head as he went away. I've never saw George Foreman tired yet. George Foreman lately haven't heard the man say, round four, round seven, round nine, round 13.
The fight itself was to be the supreme example of Ali's psychological brilliance. Up against the most feared puncher in the world, Ali audaciously decided to sit on the ropes and take everything Foreman could throw. It was designed to both exhaust and demoralize George.
That punch did no damage, that one did. Two wild right hands taken on the side of the head of Muhammad Ali. Unusually slow with his hands. Look at this. All of a sudden he opens up. Four punches downstairs on Ali.
I think that what Ali did in that fight against Foreman shows a great tactical sense. One can't think of many people exposing themselves, say, to a Mike Tyson on the ropes like that. It was a tremendously well-executed battle plan.
I love Ali, and I would, please don't do that. You know, you're talking to yourself, sort of thing. And all of a sudden, George comes in with all his big punches. Some he blocks, some he takes. He would push him off. Come on, come back like that. It's suicide.
Ali's fans believed it was crazy as well.
Wild right misses the head of Ali. The left taken on the glove of Ali.
But as the fight wore on, they began to understand what the master was up to. It wouldn't be long before Ali's plan paid off.
Technically, I think Ali would have been nearly as great without any of the psychological warfare, when it came to what he did in the ring. But you can't separate that, because that's what makes him a great personality, arguably the greatest personality of modern sport.
While a fantastically skilled boxer, Ali was also one of the bravest. It was a quality he needed very early in his career.
My big punch was the left hook off the left jab. And I, as I say, showed him one, showed him two. And he went back. The rope stopped him getting back anywhere when I hit him with the left hook, which caught him, connected. Yeah.
The infamous torn glove incident, which gave Ali extra recovery time, thwarted Henry's chances of a stoppage. But it was the first time Ali's fighting heart had really been tested, as he came out for the fifth.
Well, Ali was a brave fighter. If he was it, he always got up off the deck. Oh, he had what we say in boxing, he had plenty of heart.
As young Cassius Clay makes good his prediction of a fifth-round KO.
Sonny Liston had annihilated Floyd Patterson before Ali met him in their first world title fight. Just 22 at the time, Ali has since admitted he was terrified of Liston and began acting like a madman before the fight.
an unheard-of thing happened at the Main Street Gym in Miami. Challenger Cassius invaded while Liston was training. Sonny had to be restrained to protect Clay, supposedly.
It was his way of trying to overcome the quite genuine nervousness. Perhaps fear is too strong a word, but certainly he was very much in awe of the man he was going to fight. And he knew he had to try and bring him down to his level. I think one of the classic examples of his courage, though, is when he fought and got beaten by Kenny Norton in the first of their three fights. He had his jaw broken in the second round, and he fought from round two right through to round 12, losing decision with a broken jaw.
Ali in desperate trouble here in the 12th and final round.
That is incredible courage.
Norton applying the pressure, sharp, crisp punches.
Some real good shots.
For many, Ali's raw courage and resilience was never better exemplified than in the Foreman fight.
Foreman on the left of your screen, Ali on the right. Ali leans up against the rope. Right hand taken on the gloves by Ali. There's a real wild right hand taken in the back of the head of Ali.
I could just hear the thump, thump, thump of those fists against his rib cage, against his kidneys. He just allowed Foreman to punch himself out on his body. Now, it takes a very rash man or a very brave man to do that kind of thing.
But Ali had been working on it in the gym in Africa, training his body to endure huge body shots.
Ali lays all over the ropes, makes every sparring partner look like a world beater.
I don't think he sort of thing will have to be really brave here. He just accepted that came with the territory anyway. And the territory was his territory. I think from way back when he was an amateur, this started, he always felt as if the ring and the area and the titles was his. He was the king of the jungle, like, you know, he was the lion, and all these others were just subordinates, you know.
This unforgettable body punch was delivered in the third fight with Ken Norton in 1976.
Good shot to the body, double up Ali.
As ever, Ali refused to show he'd been hurt.
He had tremendous courage and he had a tremendous chin. I'll never forget that left hook that Fraser exploded on Ali's chin in the 15th in the last round. It would have felled an ox.
An explosive left to the jaw, and Muhammad Ali goes down. Let's watch this perfectly timed left to the jaw. There it is, and down goes Muhammad.
And Ali rolled over and was up on his feet at five.
Arthur Mercanni wipes off the gloves, and Joe Fraser moves in to finish it. Hanging on. Joe is all over Muhammad Ali. Left and right to the body. Muhammad Ali in desperate trouble here in the 15th round. Ali coming back. Miraculously, Ali finishing strong. And Frazier gets in with a torrid left hook. Mercanni breaks the two men. And there's the bell, ending this battle of champions.
It was sheer courage that kept Ali on his feet, though eventually he suffered a rare defeat on points. In a career which spanned the terms of seven U.S. presidents and consisted of 61 professional fights, Ali was stopped only once, in his penultimate fight with Larry Holmes. By that time, everyone except Ali believed he should have retired. But it was the trilogy of fights against Smokin' Joe Frazier which really proved what a brave fighter Ali was. This is number two at Madison Square Garden in 1974.
A punishing left to the head by Joe Frazier.
Well, I was in Manila for the thriller in Manila, the third Frazier fight, which has got to be, if not the greatest heavyweight fight of all time, certainly the most brutal and the most savage.
There's round eight.
They took everything out of each other for 14 rounds, and both men, not only Ali, Frazier, they showed bravery beyond the call of duty.
fight statisticians recorded that Frazier had connected with 444 punches. A charming man out of the ring, Ali could be as mean as hell inside. His ruthlessness is something of a forgotten quality.
When he finished a guy, when he really wanted to finish him, because, you know, it was him or the opponent, then he was second to none. He was brilliant, you know. He would pick all the shots, vary them up, and he'd take them apart. Take them to school, as we say in the business.
Oh, and a right-hand shot.
Did you see that combination of punches, Edwin?
What a showman! This must be the most unique fighters in heavyweight history.
In a one-sided fight with Brian London, Ali launched one of his most devastating assaults.
Ali moving in on London. A fuselage of punches by Muhammed Ali. London goes down. The referee sends Ali to a neutral corner and picks up the count. It doesn't appear as if London's going to be able to make it to his feet. The fight is over. Ali wins by a knockout and now has a record of 26 straight professional wins.
He hit Brian London with a series of punches. He must have hit London with about 10 punches in one combination.
Everybody regards him as a big, lovable guy, you know, full of jokes and charisma and all the rest of it. But once he got you in that ring, he was for real. And he did some very nasty things to a lot of people.
He could be a bit cruel as well and be a bit hard. He knew I had a sliced eye and he just concentrated on left jabs on my eye and it was pumping blood. And then the referee had to jump in and stop the fight because my eye was so badly cut.
A barrage of ripping punches by Clay.
Archie Moore had been a legend for years and years and he just took him apart at the seams. He just went in there, took his time, had a look at the fella, worked it out, manoeuvred him down, and just used his agility to stop the guy.
Trying to get in that one big punch to take Clay out of there. Ripping punches by Clay, and Moore goes down. Cassius raises his hands over his head. Courageously, Archie gets to his feet. Moore is sent to the canvas again by a barrage of punches. For the second time, Archie gets to his feet to face the inevitable. Ripping punches by Cassius Clay, and it's all over. Clay wins by a fourth round knockout, as predicted.
The pupil had overcome the master. Archie Moore had been Ali's first ever professional trainer. The rugged South American Oscar Bonavina was opponent number two for Ali during the comeback from his 3.5 year boxing exile. It was a tough fight, and Ali had been hurt in the ninth.
And now it's Ali in trouble. Ali is staggered. Bonavina moves in, trying to knock out Muhammad Ali here in the ninth round.
I think he knew when the chips were down how to put the pressure on, as he did against Oscar Bonavina. He knew when to execute. He knew how to gather in. He had will to win, and he had pride. Gather in all his ability and then explode.
A murderous left hook by Muhammad Ali sends Bonavina to the canvas. The referee picks up the count, and Bonavina is up at the count of seven. Ali moves in to finish it. Bonavina goes down a second time. Oscar's on his feet. One more knockdown and it's all over. There's a three knockdown rule. Ali moves in, sends gripping punches, and down goes Bonavina. Let's look at that knockout once again from an isolated camera. Ali on the right. There's that big left hook. Down goes Bonavina for the first knockdown. Oscar courageously gets to his feet. Ali goes in with another right. When Bonavina goes down for the third time, the fight is automatically over, and Muhammad Ali has shocked the boxing world once again. A magnificent return to the ring for this great champion who has never been defeated.
Oscar hadn't helped himself before the fight when he called Ali a chicken for refusing to join the army.
Why you no go to the army?
I will tell you Monday night in the first clinch.
Chicken, you chicken. Okay.
Good deal. Keep talking.
Chicken.
Keep talking. Now I know you're going to get a whooping. Did you cut your hair?
Okay, go ahead.
Did you cut your hair?
Go ahead.
I'll cut your
hair. You push me now.
He never should have started talking. Not with Muhammad Ali.
Ali? Clay. You Clay?
I said Muhammad Ali.
Clay?
You will call it when the fight comes on.
Clay?
Wait till the fight comes
on. Clay?
Please tell everybody to get to your theaters. I've never had a man that I wanted to whoop so bad.
But there was another man, Joe Frazier. Having scored one win apiece, neither Frazier nor Ali was going to give up in their decider without a brutal fight. The thriller in Manila was a classic example of Ali's ruthlessness in the ring.
Gets it or not is something else.
You can see the state of Frazier's face after 13 rounds of Ali hooking, jabbing. His face was like a piece of raw meat. Both eyes were closed, particularly the right eye. Joe couldn't see. He was just fighting on sheer instinct. And Ali, I think, sensed that there wasn't very much left. So he went after him like a man possessed.
Frazier's badly hurt.
One of the most brutal fights of all time, certainly the most brutal heavyweight fight. Look at poor old Joe, staggering back to his corner. Ali slumped in his. Two men who had given their all, very little left. Eddie Futch, say the fight's over.
I think it's gonna be over. It's all over.
That was the time when he made that famous remark. That's the closest I've been to death.
But it was the Foreman fight, the rumble in the jungle in Zaire, which brought out so many of Ali's qualities. His cool, clinical mind was crucial.
Here we go, the bell sounds, round number eight, and an even fight.
This is the famous eighth round. Foreman has been blasting away at Ali's body for seven rounds, but Ali senses that Big George has virtually nothing left.
And that time a straight left bounces the head back of Foreman. Quick, short jab with the right hand bounces the head around of Foreman. Foreman looking to deliver the real heavy blows. Now he's bouncing better. Almost falls out of the ring. Ali left that punch, twisted his body to the side, and the left hand went kind of over the shoulder. Ali bends him over. Zach Clayton right on the spot, the referee, chairman of the Pennsylvania State Boxing Commission. Ali, it seems to be, well, kind of going the way he wants. He's not dancing as much as we thought, but he seems able to control him. Now, some pretty good heavy right hand taken on the left side of the cheek by Ali. Good right hand thrown by Foreman that time. Again, for Foreman, it seems to be one or two, maybe three good punches. That punch taken on the glove, that one slips by the left ear, tries to go with that right uppercut that felled Kenny Norton. The left hand again thrown out by Foreman. Both fighters now very much more fatigued than they were a round or so ago. The heat is pretty high here, around 80 degrees. The humidity is probably 85 to 90. At age 32, Muhammad Ali is bouncing around pretty good for the 24-year-old Foreman, hanging pretty tough in there. Again, I caution you to look for the one punch that George Foreman can deliver at any time. This man is devastating, to say the least. These punches are not at this particular time. Try to pull a sneaky right hand on Ali. Ali hanging on, getting away with it. Getting away with it. The left hand taken on the side of Ali's cheek. The left hook again on the side of the glove. Right hand by Foreman was not effective. The right uppercut did bounce the head a little bit. Punches will not hurt Ali. Ali just takes him, protecting his face at all times, does Ali. Foreman throwing more punches now. Maybe this could be the tactic of Ali, to let the man punch himself out. 30 seconds left in round 8. Very even fight. Ali, a sneaky right hand. Another sneaky right hand. This time he works over the shoulder of Foreman.
I think the finish against Foreman was so dramatic, the circling motion and the man falling, you'd never forget it.
Watch it, and that was no phantom, that was no phantom punch, that was no phantom punch, and he's down and out.
I'd seen so many things he'd done over the years, but that for me was absolutely, no one would have expected him to do that, nobody, not against a fierce puncher like Foreman, but it was brilliant.
Softened his man up. They said Ali didn't have a killer punch. Well, that was it. But my God, he softened his man up. And
the whole fight had been a clinical exhibition. Confounding everyone, he outfought and outthought George Foreman.
He was a one-off and he was an all-time great. And he would go in the halls of fame of all boxing.
There was no one, and there will never be anybody quite like Muhammad Ali.
In my opinion, he was easily the greatest heavyweight who ever lived.
To me, it was as if he was almost on a mission. He transcended boxing.
He was the best heavyweight I've ever seen, and I'm glad I was alive in that era to watch him do it. He was brilliant. Second to none.
What a character this man! What a showman! Muhammad Ali has done it! The great man has done it!
This is champion Muhammad Ali at his brilliant best.
This must be surely one of the most unique fighters in heavyweight history.
I shook up the world! I shook up the world! I shook up the world!